never close your eyes. I love that chord. In the key of C, it'll be, you never close your eyes anymore when I kiss your lips.
There's no tenderness like grief in your fingertips. You're trying hard.
You've Lost That Loving Feeling has had more radio plays than any other song in the history of modern popular music. It was a song born of the marriage between a figure new to the music industry, the record producer, and Tin Pan Alley, the traditional home of commercial songwriting in the heart of New York's theatre district. Their union would give birth to the modern pop song. But when these two forces first met at the beginning of the 50s, what passed for pop music was this.
How much is that dog in the window?
The one with the waggly tail.
How much is that dog in the window? I do hope that dog is for sale. I must take a trip to California and leave my poor sweetheart.
The themes were innocent. They were light romance. They were novelty.
When I released Doggy in the Window, there was a real fashion for novelty songs. The DJs did like to have something different, and when we recorded it, we added the little bark. And I've seen through the years, even dogs that people have taught their dogs to bark at the right time on the Doggy in the Window song.
How much is that doggy in the window? The one with the waggly tail. Much is that doggy in the window? I do hope that dog is for sale.
America was booming, a nation awash with shiny consumer goods. Built-in obsolescence was the new mantra, and music followed the trend.
One of the funny things, or paradoxical things, of a number of the successful songs of the early 50s is that they're written by Tin Pan Alley veterans. It is almost a dumbing down of the kind of skills that seemed called upon in the most successful and the most lauded of the earlier popular music associated with Tin Pan Alley. There was this almost throwing out of some of those rules and just going for something which was going to be almost mindless.
The old Tin Pan Alley certainties of quality songs for quality singers was no longer generating enough sales for the record companies. Enter Mitch Miller, the first of a new breed we now call the record producer.
What I would think is, I want to make the picture alive through the listener's ear. You wanted to have catch their ear
in the first four bars.
So that somebody liked it enough so that they wanted to buy it. And to buy it, they meant to play it over and over again. Like kissing. You don't kiss once and say that's enough for the night. And in a way, it's lovemaking to the audience with music.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Miller's choice of material often frustrated artists, like aspiring jazz singer Frankie Lane.
He called me from New York. He says, he always called me Daddy-O. He says, Daddy-O, he says, I got a follow-up hit. And he played it for me on the phone. I said, oh, Jesus, Mitch, if I do that, I'll lose every jazz fan I've ever had. He says, yeah, maybe so, but you'll pick up a lot of fans who aren't listening to you now. Well, that impressed me.
All up along, the focus was on the song itself. And in the 1920s, say, if My Blue Heaven was the big hit, you might have bought the record, but chances are you bought the sheet music and you went home and played it on your piano. Even if you were a lousy piano player, you could still essentially get, you know, My Blue Heaven in your home, played by you on your piano. Whereas by the time of something like Mule Train, if you liked that song, it just made no sense to go out and buy the sheet music and try and play it, because there was no way you could replicate anything like that. Anything you could do on the piano would just be, you know, ridiculous.
Mule Train, leaving, clapping over heel and plain. Seems as how they never stop. Clippity-clop, clippity-clop, clippity-clippity, clippity-clippity, clippity-clop. clapping along.
Before this, when people went in to record, it was really a record, like a document of what they did on stage, what a dance band did in a ballroom, or what Al Jolson sang on stage, or even Bing Crosby, too. So they were just capturing a sound that was you heard in real life.
The whole thing that I think Mitch brought about was the idea of that a record could be something, in, you know, an end unto itself. You know, the whole idea now is to sell these singles, and the single is the product itself.
Liberty clapping through the wind and rain. They'll keep going till they drop. Liberty clap, liberty clap, liberty, 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 liberty clapping along.
Miller was a classical musician who brought a whole new palette of orchestral instruments into the pop studio that had never been heard there before. Timpani, harpsichords, and even bagpipes. The weirder the better, so long as it hooked the ear of the listener.
Mitch was one of the earliest guys to realize that if you're trying to make records that are getting radio play, you have to come up with something that's going to grab the listener within a few seconds, you know, 10 seconds at most.
Come on to my house, I'm going to give you candy. Come on to my house, I'm gonna give you apple, plum, and a bomb.
When I did Come On to My House, I heard it on an obscure label in a wholly different version. And it gave me the idea to do it with Rosemary Clooney with a harpsichord.
Come On to My House hits you with everything it's got in the first, you know, 5 seconds. You got this incredibly catchy beat, you've got this really kind of silly, fun lyric, and you've got harpsichords, and it's kind of highbrow and lowbrow at the same time, because you have all these classical instruments going on. There's no way it couldn't have grabbed you.
Come on to my house, come on. Come on to my house, I'm gonna give you peach and pear, and I love your hair.
Well, look, you can just eat the same menu every day. You can eat steak and potatoes every day. You can eat McDonald's every day. You want something different for your ear. A change of menu.
Come on to my house.
Miller's quest for a new modern sound took him to some strange places.
Can you hear the echo in here? All right, see. It wasn't my idea. I just said to Bob Fine, that a legendary engineer, put a halo around the voice. All the records of pop singers sound like they're singing through a hunk of wool. And next thing you know, the next session we had, He rigged up a microphone going to a toilet, and he had a loudspeaker in the toilet, and he had a microphone with a line coming back, and so he'd take the original sound and just crack in some of the sound here, so everybody sounds vibrant in the bathroom. I sound like an opera singer. Tony I end up being Pavarotti, yeah? And for months, other record labels went crazy. They didn't know how he did it. Of course, when the word got out, next thing you know, you had echo chambers, but the original echo chamber was a toilet.
You know, the Mitch Miller sound was, you know, something that was like uniform. It almost didn't matter who the singer was, because the production became much more important. And if it had, you know, Rosemary Clooney's voice on it or Tony Bennett's voice, so much the better. But, you know, you could pretty much tell it was a Mitch Miller production even before the singer started.
Jezebel.
TV was the latest luxury for the family to share, replacing radio as the medium for music with broad appeal. Pop vocalists like Perry Como, Rosemary Clooney, and Frankie Lane all hosted their own primetime shows. Television offered a home to Tin Pan Alley. Radio was now the place to find the more niche music associated with America's different regions. It spoke to quite separate audiences, for the many different genres of music that were unlikely to find a home on network television, or in the national pop charts.
If you liked hillbilly music, it was called, there was a hillbilly chart, and there were records that were just made for the country and Western audiences. And if you lived in New York, it was very unlikely that you would be able to even, you know, buy a country Western record, because they just weren't sold in New York. And if you lived in the white areas in New York, you'd have to go up to Harlem to buy a Race record, to buy a Nat King Cole Trio record or something like that. They're separate, and to a degree, you wouldn't even know that these other kinds of music exist. What starts to happen, thanks to Mitch Miller in particular and other people, is that things from like the folk genre and the country genre gradually come over. Tennessee Waltz, the first sign that country music is becoming more and more important, and the Patti Page record of it is just about the biggest selling single of all time after White Christmas.
I was dancing with my darling to the Tennessee Waltz when an old friend I happened to see.
We have to remember, too, a good part of the dominant record industry and music business as a whole at that point in time, country music is still being seen as, to remember one of its early less than friendly designations, as shit kicker music. You know, as music for hillbillies and rednecks.
This is the best song we've ever had, financially. A little tune called Cold, Cold Heart. I try so hard, my
I was a big fan of Hank Williams, and country music was just not being done in the big metropolitan areas. And I brought Mitch a song called Cold, Cold Heart.
Play 8 bars of Hank Williams with a scratchy fiddler. He sings great, and it's a strong. I tried to, why don't you free my doubtful mind and melt your cold, cold heart? Wow, there's no better 2 lines ever written by... And when Jerry Wexler told me about it, he said, listen. So I immediately thought of Tony Bennett. And I played the Hank Williams record for Bennett. And he said, oh, you don't want me to do those cowboy songs. I said, Tony, don't listen to the arrangement. Listen to the words. And he did, and of course, it was a big, big hit.
I tried so hard, my dear, to show that you're my every dream. Yet you're afraid each thing I do is just some evil scheme. A memory.
That was Mitch Miller. He was the first one to tap into country where no one else, any of the cities, they just said, what are you doing, you know? And Mitch did have the foresight to actually say, this is where it's happening. And we put a big string orchestra behind Cold Cold Heart. And in about 2 months, it ended up selling, in those days, it was huge. It sold 2 million records.
What you're getting is you're getting this style of song, grassroots we'll call it, filtered through the popular singing styles of the Patti Pages, of the Doris Days, of Tony Bennett. You're getting it filtered through people who had come up through the big bands, who had learned, been trained to sing in the popular style, but are singing songs from below, are singing the country songs. The raw material, some would say in Tin Pan Alley, the sewage is about to come through, but it's being treated, it's going through a treatment process, a syrupy process perhaps.
I learned to care for you, the more we drift apart.
These country boys had very, very simple harmonies and chords because they were singing simple songs about life. And life is simple. Life is direct. Life is about good and bad and jealousy and hate and rage and love and joy and things like that.
I got this call from Hank Williams. And he said, Tony, I said, Mr. Williams, what is it? He said, what's the idea of ruining my song? And he was just kidding around, actually. He liked it.
You're cheating hard. We'll tell on.
I think this erosion between musical genres that one sees in this early crossover material is providing kind of the bedrock for what is going to be in several years rock and roll.
The ironic thing is that Mitch Miller claims to hate rock and roll, and I'm sure he's sincere in that, but of course he created it. I mean, that whole rock and roll could not have existed had he not been doing what he, you know, was doing for 10 years before it. I mean, there were no producers who would have gone in the studio and used all the tricks that he invented, the echo chambers and the sound effects and all the and the overdubbing and stuff like that. I mean, that all exists because of Mitch, and there certainly couldn't have been any rock and roll without him.
It's going to be one big night in.
John, he claimed he has the music, but he's having a lot of fun.
Once this high-energy new music began kicking down the doors, the teenage dollar started talking, and supply quickly followed demand. Rock and roll was taking over the music business. The older generation of professional songwriters was outraged. Halfway down Broadway, the Brill Building had housed some of the greatest of Tin Pan Alley songwriters. Here, the music establishment had always prided itself on being able to spot musical trends and lead musical taste.
Tin Pan Alley was very upset with this. The Tin Pan Alley songs, songs that originated in the East, particularly in New York, were no longer hitting the top of the hit parade, were no longer selling many copies. It was rock and roll. Tin Pan Alley responded really by a kind of hostility. There was no real policy about it, but certainly there's a kind of, they all got their backs up, Irving Berlin. I mean, all the old traditional writers were incredibly hostile to it. Frank Sinatra was constantly denouncing rock and roll in one way or another. They felt that somehow the musical heritage that they represented was being flushed away by this, what they considered to be junk music.
Rock and roll has got to go, and go it does.
It concerned parents, it concerned preachers, teachers, legislators, that there was some kind of an evil influence coming into the music, and it was going to pervert the sensibilities of the young.
The people that were branding it demon rock and roll and condemning it, you know, because it had a black background, or condemning it for moral reasons, I think that's a very overblown, very small segment of the population. I think most of the record industry was happy to have some new gimmick to sell records with. And, you know, and the business of America is business. Anything that sells and is profitable, people are going to like.
Why should the Alley men be frightened of rock and roll when the anthem of rock and roll, Rock Around the Clock, was written by Max C. Friedman, who was a veteran songwriter of Tin Pan Alley, who'd had hits going back to the 1920s. I mean, he was a man in his 60s who wrote Rock Around the Clock, so what were they to be frightened about? There was going to be plenty of gravy for them on the rock and roll train.
1, 2, 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, rock. 5, 6, 7 o'clock, 8 o'clock, rock.
Now, the important lines here, this clarion call to come and join in rock and roll. Get your glad rags on and join me, hun. We'll have some fun when the clock strikes one. That's telling the kids there's a new sound happening. It's a clarion call. It's the rock and roll equivalent of Irving Berlin's come on in here, come on in here, Alexander's ragtime band is saying, come in, here's the new fad, ragtime, same thing here. Come and join in rock and roll, it's the new thing.
But the experienced writers of the Brill Building would soon have competition. Heading into town was a fresh generation with their sights set on Tin Pan Alley. They were first wave rock and rollers with a passion for teenage music, because they were still in their teens themselves. At 1650 Broadway, a young publisher called Don Kirshner had just opened the doors of Aldon Music to create a home for these new songwriters. The very first writing team to walk in was the 18-year-old Neil Sedaka and his lyricist, Howard Greenfield.
I was very short, Howie was very tall, very strange-looking couple, and they said, where did you steal these songs? Because I sat down and I did my little number, and they said, these aren't your songs. I said, oh, yes, they are. And Don Kirshner said, oh, well, I know Connie Francis. You must play this for her. And I said, oh, I was so excited. Connie Francis, the number one female vocalist in the world.
And I said, look, we got to go to Jersey. And if I get a record with Connie Francis, will you sign with me for 5 years? And I think they thought I was a little crazy or whatever. And they said, okay, we'll do that. We went to Connie.
And I sat and played her all of my best ballads, because she had just had Who's Sorry Now, the number one record in the country. So I thought for sure she would do a ballad. And she wasn't very interested doing her paperwork, and I was singing and nobody was interested. And then I whispered to Howie, I'm going to play Stupid Cupid. He said, how could you do that? You promised it to the Shepherd Sisters. I said, I don't care. I'm with Connie Francis, the number one female vocalist.
I've started this 12-bar blues because she liked Joanne Campbell, who was a blues singer. Stupid Cupid, you're a real mean guy. I like to clip your wings so you can fly. I'm in love and it's a crying shame. And I know that you're the one to blame. Hey, hey, set me free. Stupid Cupid, stop picking on me. She said, I'll take it. It's my next record.
Hey, hey, set me free. Stupid Cupid, stop picking on me.
With the success of Stupid Cupid, Aldon were up and running. Kirshner set about drawing together a tight group of young New York talent, which soon would be writing the most memorable songs of the era.
You got me jumping like a crazy clown.
Danny Kirshner and his crew of songwriters was almost like a reversion back to the 20s, where the publishers in Tin Pan Alley would have an office with a dozen rooms or so, and in each one there'd be a songwriter, a team of songwriters, grinding songs out.
Barry Mann and Cynthia Weil went on to write classic songs like Uptown, On Broadway, and We've Gotta Get Out of This Place. They too got their big break at Don Kirshner's Aldon Music.
When we started writing at 1650, at least I didn't feel we were part of a Tin Pan Alley tradition. We were kind of the antichrist
exactly.
to those people.
Yeah, we really
you
were.
Know?
Yeah, we really kind of, we didn't look down on it, but even the music was kind of moving on. Even though we would still write at the time, still you could still get a Perry Como record or an Andy Williams record. But music was really changing, and in a way, we really kind of looked
we
down.
We were the bridge.
We always thought that we were the bridge between the old Tin Pan Alley and rock and roll.
The environment was so energetic and so electric. So one songwriting team, Man and Wild, would write, You Lost That Loving Feeling. Goffin and King would be in another room writing Up on the Roof. Sadaka would be doing Breaking Up Is Hard to Do in another cubicle. What they did was songs that really came from the heart, that they felt, that they experienced. And they felt that if they could put it on paper, or the teenagers would be no different than them. And most of the songs, if you analyze it, they had a universal and global quality which everybody could relate to.
In Billboard magazine, there's a page called The Hits of the World. They still have it. And I looked at the top songs in each country and bought the records and analyzed why they were hit records. There was a certain drum beat, a certain guitar lick, the harmonic rhythm where the chords changed. Girls' names were very big. I took all of these ingredients and I put them together and I came up with...
Oh, Carol, I am but a fool. Darling, I love you. Though you treat me cruel.
Here were people who were just slightly older than the audience that they were writing for, and who saw, and many of them had musical training. Many of them had gone to Juilliard or Curtis or places like that. They had classical musical training, but at the same time, they loved rock and roll. And they thought there should be some way of bringing this together. I mean, that was part of the fun of it, too. The fun of it was not to see music as being classical music here, Broadway music here, rock and roll music here, but to see them as all having elements that could be drawn upon. I mean, it's a kind of synthesis.
This is where my classical music comes in. I was studying a Villa-Lobos piece, great composer from Brazil, and there was a piece that went... I forget, it was from the Dahl family suite.
And I wanted the 1-6-2-5. And then in the chorus, I wanted a little when you're making love, that pause, and then the finale, you know, just that little pause before the.
Inspiration for the song was Neil Sedaka's former sweetheart, Carole King. She also joined the Al Don fold, aged 19. Her first assignment, written with husband Jerry Goffin, was a song destined to become a classic.
Will You Love Me Tomorrow was the first hit song that Jerry and I ever had as songwriters. It was we were married and just starting out. And Jerry had a job as a chemist, and when Will You Love Me Tomorrow hit really big, he could quit his day job and become a full-time songwriter, so that was kind of exciting. Tonight you're mine completely. You give your love so sweetly. Tonight the light of love is in your eyes. But will you love me?
Will You Love Me Tomorrow was a milestone song. It was the first time any girl group, black or white, had hit the number one spot. The song opened the road to a raft of new artists and a new kind of songwriting.
The lyrics of Will You Love Me Tomorrow, they were a little more thoughtful than perhaps the average pop song was at the time. They definitely spoke for women, young women all over, who were wondering if they should do it or not. Will you respect me in the morning?
Love Me Tomorrow was a song about sex. It was a very adult song for the girls to be singing, you know, very, very an adult song. But it was a great song because it wasn't a dirty song.
It has a very, very strong tune. It's almost classically structured, some lovely chord changes in it, quite unlike rhythm and blues songs or songs from the black field, which have a much more a blues basis in the blues scale. And I think there you have this wonderful synthesis, this meeting of black sensibility, of the sort of fervent, gospel-inspired singing with a beautifully constructed song that almost has classical intervals and classical chords.
Will you still love me tomorrow?
What started to change, what became more and more apparent, was that you were getting songs really from a female perspective, often written by women songwriters as well. Will You Still Love Me Tomorrow is a question from a woman's point of view. Leslie Gore, say, who backed up by a girl group and as a female singer, takes this kind of influence, starts out with a song like It's My Party, I Can Cry If I Want To, a kind of teenage angst song, but then a year or two later comes out with You Don't Own Me. I mean, what a statement here. A kind of precedent even for Aretha Franklin with Respect there. And other kinds of songs that are saying, there is a female point of view.
Young girls were still idolizing the young male pop idols, and now there was an opportunity for the young women to see themselves, to identify in a new, in a more personal way. Perfect example of two guys who are beginning to get that there are women out there who've got a message to send. And after I heard the lyric and realized that this is definitely a lyric I want to sing, I was tremendously taken by the structure. It starts out in a minor key, so you get this tremendous pathos. It's almost almost an Israeli kind of a lament. And then you come into this, don't tell me what to do. It switches to the major key, and I always just got goosebumps. And it's such a tremendous, almost a physical difference that you feel when you hear that change. And that's what gave the song so much hope. That's what gave the song so much power. When it came into the major, you had this sense that you were really capturing freedom and that you were really making these demands.
While young writers were breathing new life and new values into Tin Pan Alley, another force was changing the shape of pop with the emergence of the Svengali producer.
This spacious mansion is built on one man's capacity for long-range survival in the unpredictable record business.
Phil Spector is 25 years old. He owns record and publishing companies valued in the millions. He began to compose, arrange, and sing at the age of 16.
Phil Spector was the absolute master of the music studio. His signature wall of sound recordings all bore the same unique audio fingerprint, with their Wagner-like piling on of reverberating instrument after instrument. Working with the pick of Tin Pan Alley's brightest young songwriters, the Spectre touch could turn a song to gold.
A song like the Do Run Run, I think it's such a simple song that it's kind of has a very natural flow to it. It kind of like falls out of you. Now, writing it with Phil and Jeff, we just sat there, and Jeff would tap on the piano, Phil would strum on a guitar, I'd play the piano, and we would just start, and somehow, over there, yes, my, oh, okay, hold on. And we would just go into it and it would kind of form itself. Those kind of songs are relatively easy to write. How to have that big sound and a ba-dum, yes, all carrying on. Without that arrangement, without that stuff, I don't know where that song would sit. There had to be a ba-dum, ba-dum leading to that. It just, you'd even sing that when you were writing a song. Ba-dum, ba-dum, yes. Pick me up with seven and he looks so fine. We could have done the drawing around like this. I met him on a Sunday and my heart stood still. Hello? A ballad. Did you run? I don't think so.
Phil Spector was the archetype. He never saw a song, he saw a record. And the whole record was in his mind. It was, to me, it's a genius level of what he did, because that whole record would crawl out of his brain like a maggot coming out of somebody's ear, finished, ready to go. The wall of sound, three pianos, six guitars, and that what you might call consider to be an infernal din as the background, as all these things melded together, proved to be the absolutely ineluctable and seductive sound for the teenagers.
Okay, let's forget about the intro for now. Let's just come right in. One, two, three.
Darlene Love, seen here on the right, had grown up singing tight gospel harmonies in church. As Spector's favorite backing singer, she would sometimes sing the lead vocal on records he would later release under another artist's name.
I used to stay in the studio late with Phil Spector, probably one of the very few singers that actually did that back in those days, because I wanted to hear and see everything that they were doing with the record. And I can remember Phil Spector and the engineer working till 2, 3, 4 o'clock in the morning, bringing it down. And I couldn't understand what they were doing or what they were talking about. He actually took a little bitty speaker that was no bigger than probably this and put his ear up to it. And I'm saying, what is he doing? What is going on? He said he wanted to hear each instrument, how it was going to sound when they heard it coming through the radio, mostly the radio in their car.
I remember hearing, I used to have a 1935 Ford Coupe, candy apple red with a white oral on top. And I was sitting in it one day, had the radio on, and I heard Phil Spector's production of the Crystal song, Uptown. And it was the first time I'd ever heard low strings introduced in a rock and roll song, and I just loved it. And I said, I'm gonna write their next single, never thinking in a million years I could ever pull it off. It just flowed, it just came with that opening riff. I had this. And it was, see the way he walks down the street, see the way he shuffles his feet, how he holds his head up high when he goes walking by. I could die.
Spector was the fulfillment of the phenomenon initiated by Mitch Miller, the incarnation of producer pop. Whoever the artist might be, it was always recognizable as a Phil Spector record.
Phil Spector knew exactly what he wanted. He knew exactly what the kind of music he wanted them to play. The only thing Phil would want me to do was sing my melody. I don't want you going off on this song. If this is the way, see the way he walks down the street. Don't say, see the way he walks down the street. Or, you know, just stay right here in the pocket. Amazingly, Phil Spector put that record out so fast, the real Crystals were on the road traveling with Gene Pitney, who wrote He's a Rebel.
And opening night, the Crystals came to me and asked me if I would coach them in singing the song on piano. And I thought, that's unusual. They've got it out, and it's a big hit. And of course, it was a different Crystals. It wasn't the same people that sang the song.
Gene Pitney's career as a singer was equally successful. He was offered a Brill Building song from Hal David and Burt Bacharach.
Now, that started with two trumpets, and they had a tension. You don't hear them on the piano necessarily, but they started like this. You recall that. And then the rhythm came in. That started the whole record off with that tension that I felt was indicative of the lyric that Hal David wrote.
24 Hours from Tulsa is, you know, one of my favorite songs. It's a story it's a short story song. I try to do that as often as I can if the melody leads me down that road, and that melody sure did. I mean, hopefully every lyric writer hears something when they hear music, more than just the music. The music has to say something to you. And the music said 24 hours from Tulsa and told me that whole story. But I had never been to Tulsa. I don't know, the sound of it sounded good. Tulsa sounded right.
Burt came in and sat down and played it. And there's one thing about Burt Bacharach as well. I've tried to explain this to people, and it's difficult. But Burt's not really a trained singer. He doesn't have a great voice. And I think his instrument is actually trumpet, more so than piano. But when he sits down and plays a song for you, you're never going to do it as good as him. I don't know what it is about it, but he has, there's a piece of him that he leaves in every one of his songs.
You know, right away, that's like pretty damn good. That's really like, that captures your ear. I mean, you hear that much. Well, you were talking about different. That's different. Right off the bat, that's different.
I tried to emulate it, and like I said, he was doing that thing with dearest. I can see him with his head. Dearest. Dearest.
Dearest. Darling, I had to write to say that I won't be home anymore, for something happened to me while I was driving home, and I'm not the same anymore. Oh, I was only 24 hours from Tulsa.
Where do you place the title? That's the first thing a lyric writer says to himself, or even asks if he's confused to the composer. Where do you hear the title? It seems perfect when you find the spot for it, and you can't, nobody would. Well, that's the only place it could be, but that's not true. It could be in a lot of places.
I was only 24 hours from Tulsa. Only one day away from your arms. The jukebox started to play, and night turned into day.
Now, something else happened in the middle of that record when the lyrics said, and we were dancing closely. Everything was doubled up. The time suddenly was twice as fast. The trumpets were double tonguing like.
Yes, we were dancing closely. All of a sudden I lost control as I held her charms. And I caressed her, kissed her, told her I'd die before I would let her out of my arms. Oh, I was only 24 hours from Tulsa.
We were going for a peak that would make the record rise up to finally come down. Now, we only had 2.5 minutes to do it in. So we were looking for that complete rise, the maximum, and then come to the utter despair at the end. Do you remember the last lyric was, I never can go home anymore. And there was that guitar chord. I hate to do this to you.
I love somebody new. What can I do when I can never, never, never go home again?
Tin Pan Alley was back on form, with songs that could be both sophisticated and commercial. In this atmosphere of newfound confidence, and with Phil Spector's masterful production, Man and Wild created the most played record of all time.
I'd get down on my knees for you.
We were living in New York at the time, and Phil was back in California, and he wanted to write with us. And so we ended up flying out to California, and he played us this group, this Righteous Brothers, who were just a local group from Orange County, and he played us a little at Loopy Lou and My Babe, talking about my baby, and both. And he said, you know, why don't we try to come up with something for them? And at the time, we loved Baby, I Need Your Lovin'.
Baby, I need your lovin'.
It was the template that we used when we wrote Love and
Fun. Write something, I wanted to write something with that kind of passion.
Right, yeah.
Because I thought it was such an emotional, passionate song.
We wrote a verse and a chorus, two verses and a chorus, before Phil got involved.
Thinking that we would get a better title. We were using You've Lost That Love and Feeling as kind of a dummy title.
You never close your eyes anymore
when I kiss your lips. And there's no tenderness like
before. So when we sang with Phil on the phone, he says, and we said, but that's just the dummy title. He said, no, it's not. He said, that's the title, you know.
So then we got together with him and wrote, you know, the rest of it, which was like going off into a completely different direction that we never would have thought of without him.
And I'm sure that they took a little liberties themselves.
Yeah.
I mean that hind of that Bobby did, you know, when he goes way up there. I didn't do that. That was a great combination of a really great song, great artist, great production. And but even though that it was great, we never thought that song would end up becoming the most played song of the 20th century. It blows our mind.
There's no room.
But even as Tin Pan Alley hit another peak with You've Lost That Loving Feeling, the role of the professional songwriter was again under threat. This time in the shape of four young musicians from Liverpool who wrote their own material and whose influence was about to change the American music scene forever.